This was a very good quarter. Everyone knew that December was weak. I think there are some people who said, you know what, I didn't know the trading could bring them down that much. There are so many lines that were good in this quarter. And by the way, I have to tell you, that stock, which is now up, I actually felt that it wouldn't necessarily be up this much, if only because Marion Lake, who's fabulous, CFO, did talk about how they had to tighten things because they're worried. And they did talk about construction, the need to be able to pull in just in case things got, let's just say things fell off the rails. I think that this is a Jay Powell reprieve stock. I think they were ready for Jay to kill the economy. Jay clearly wanted to do that, but he would never use those terms. And when Jay let up, you want to buy JP Morgan. I mean, Jay is completely, look, Jay looked at one number. Don't you love Jay? Like, he's like Jay. He looked at one number, and the number he looked at was employment. The numbers that you got in JP Morgan are far, the mosaic is far more important. The mosaic was mixed. But they are doing a great job.
Yeah. Okay, so you said something this morning on Squawk on the Street, which sort of caught my ear. You weren't talking about JPM, but it made me think about them. You said, hedge fund guys, they love to talk about their winners, and they ignore their losers.
Oh, I'm so sick of it.
That they're fallible. Okay, which made me think about the quarter. And I think about Goldman Sachs and Citigroup. You know, Goldman's coming.
Right.
If JP Morgan and Citigroup can't sort of understand the volatility and profit from it in the fourth quarter, should we believe that Goldman Sachs is going to be able to do it when they have their numbers?
I think Goldman has to pay people less. I think that's a terrible thing, but they're just, you know, this is a new world. You can't use your capital the way you did. I think that the really good article in the New York Times today about Malaysia is going to stick. I said last night that I think Mike Corbat's the winner, because they have a huge Asian business, and I think that there will be reputational risk. I think there'll be people who say, listen, I am not going to, if you're in other countries, Singapore, I don't know whether, it's ex-Japan, but even if you're doing any deal of Philippines, I think you might just say, listen, I got to be a little more circumspect about Goldman. But Goldman stock is trading as if it's Bethlehem Steel about to go out of business, and they're not. I think they'll do fine. I don't think they'll do better than fine. They'll do fine. They can't say, listen, we want to take a $7 billion reserve, because then that's how much they're going to have to pay. And they also can't say we're not worried about the Justice Department, because the Justice Department will crush them. So you're not going to get any clarity about Malaysia, and I think that's going to make people feel negative.
Of the controversial names, though, you have Goldman and you have Wells Fargo.
Right.
Those are two, right?
Right.
When you look at Wells Fargo's quarter, we knew that the problems were going to be markets related, fee income related, and that's exactly what we got. Disappointing numbers on that front.
Right.
Also, by the way, you got very good credit quality and you got better than expected loan growth. We have been waiting forever for better loan growth, and they actually saw it and they printed it. Now, they're going to have a cap on their capital for the year, which is why the stock is down. But I think with a free cash flow yield at 9%, trading at 9x forward, that one over Goldman, to me, makes sense.
But
they're both controversial.
One is
but one, I
you
think
can put one behind him.
Yeah.
Tim Sloan has almost got this behind him.
Right.
Tremendous job.